Hello there, how have you been? You made it to level 4? Wow, that's great. Of course we remember you and we are very proud of you. For level 4, you received 2 books, right? Shall we start the walkthrough? This is the level 4 walkthrough. So the 2 books were one book containing the 3 rounds and one book, a hardcover book with all the 1,000 words and their meanings. This one. So you have finished 600 words approximately in the last 2 levels. The last set of words and special words would be new, 400 words approximately. We have brought all the 1,000 words you mastered this year in a single book with their phonetic transcriptions, forms, meanings, other related words, and pictures. You deserve a copy of this. This is a collectible, your personal word bank. Yes, you can add to it. Go on, we challenge you to register and reach level 4 in all your high grades too, and collect as many as possible. If you manage to collect all of the books from group 1 to group 9, you would own one of the well-researched, beautifully presented, unparalleled, world-class dictionary. All the best for that. Right. Let's focus on this book. This book has your 3 rounds. Round 13, synonyms and antonyms. 14, idioms, phrases and proverbs. Round 15, presenting and arguments. So let's first see your synonyms and antonyms. Just in case you didn't know, a synonym is a word that is similar to another word. Synonyms are not exactly the same, just similar. And antonyms are words that have the opposite meaning. Sixty words from your round 1 are chosen for this round. You will find the words synonyms to their right ear and antonyms on their left. You will find that some words will have synonyms and antonyms with different meanings. That is because the word in itself can have more than one meaning and it has to be understood based on the context of the sentence. Let's see that with an example. In the sentence, it was a smooth road. The synonym of the word smooth is even. But in the sentence, it was a smooth ride. The synonym for the word smooth is pleasant. But in the sentence, it was a smooth run to victory. The synonym of the word smooth is easy. Now, do you understand? Now, let's see one for antonyms. All right. This fellow with a narrow waist is narrow-minded. Which antonyms of narrow can be used to make the sentence about this guy? See, he's embracing everyone, training everyone, believes in everyone. This fellow with a fat waist is broad-minded. You understand both these words are antonyms of narrow? Very good. But for the exam, the sentences will have only one bracket in them, not two. So let's see one for both synonym and antonym. Sirius Black was a true friend after all. Which of these words would you choose, accurate or loyal? The answer is loyal. Though accurate is a synonym of true, loyal is the word this sentence needs. We never say accurate friend. That's a wrong collocation, right? Next one. Antonym. Peter Pettigrew was the true one. Which antonym of true do we choose here? This loyal is the apt word for this sentence. Once again, bogus one, for a friend, a bogus friend, is not a correct collocation. So you understand this? We want you to develop the ability to choose the right word for the right expression. Now let's go to round number 14, idioms, phrases, and proverbs. We have three things here in this round. Let's first see what idioms are. An idiom is a group of words whose meaning cannot be understood based on individual words. For example, break a leg is a very common idiom. It means good luck. It is usually said by friends and family before an actor or any performance artist goes on stage. The standard response for this would be thanks. On cloud nine is also an idiom. This one means to be in a state of perfect happiness. Some idioms are as old as the language itself, and therefore tracing the exact origin of all the idioms are not possible, but we do know how some idioms came to be. The idiom bite the bullet is used to mean to accept something difficult or unpleasant. In the olden days, during battle, before anesthesia was invented, or when doctors were short on anesthesia, they would ask the patient to bite down on a bullet during an operation to divert attention from pain or reduce screaming. And did you know that once in a blue moon, this idiom is used to refer something that happens very rarely? You've been using this quite often, once in a blue moon. But did you know that the blue moon is a real astronomical phenomenon? The second full moon in the same month is called a blue moon. This happens every 2.7 years, that is approximately 32 months or so. Let's see one more. Let the cat out of the bag is used when someone reveals a secret or a surprise, usually by accident. In the Middle Ages, that is during 5th to 15th century, livestock such as piglets, chickens, ducks were sold in small bags to be carried home by customers. But some dishonest sellers put cats into the bags rather than the actual animals because cats were about the same size and weight but had little value. So when you let cat out of the bag, you expose the secret to everyone. You get it? So English has many interesting, colorful, and fascinating idioms such as this. Can we now go to phrases? Before that, this is how the idioms would be there in your books. Idioms with their meaning based on some theme or idea. Here we have an idiom. We have 1, 2, 3, 6 idioms based on animals. You have the meanings of those idioms and you have to put the correct idiom in the blank based on the context. For example, here we have Ray knew that tennis was her sport when she learnt it so quickly. What should be the answer there? Of these six idioms, the one that fits in that blank is like a duck to water. So this is how you will find idioms in your book. For younger groups, it will be only choose the correct answer. Now let's go to phrases. Phrases can really describe any collection of words, a group of two or more words functioning as a meaningful unit. For example, ups and downs mean good times and bad times. Spick and span means extremely neat and clean. More or less means somewhat or approximately. It has these two meanings because when somebody asks you, are you happy? If you say more or less, it means you're somewhat happy. And if it's a figure, like for example, if somebody asks you, should this be worth 200 rupees? If you say more or less, then that means approximately. And feel good factor means something that makes people feel happy and positive. Hale and hearty means very healthy. But you have to understand that there is a difference between idioms and phrases. Actually, idioms are a subset of phrases because phrases mean any group of words. Idiom comes under phrase, right? But can you find the difference between phrases and idioms? Phrases are usually direct. Even if you're unfamiliar with a particular phrase, you can guess its meaning correctly and easily. But unless you're familiar with an idiom already, it would be difficult to understand. All of a sudden, in my opinion, see you around, all these are phrases. What about a big black dog? Or after the meal? Or as soon as they came? These are phrases too. So any group of words coming together, having a meaning on its own, can be a phrase. And it can take its place in a sentence class. So you understand, phrases can be just any collection of words with some meaning. All right. So now we are going to see what proverbs are. Ha! Before that, I have to tell you how you have phrases in your book. So you have a list of phrases, and again, you have sentences with blanks in them. Based on reading the sentence, you have to choose of those phrases which can take its place in that sentence. Also, you'll have the same pattern in the examination. Now let's go to proverbs for y'all. So what are proverbs? They are short, well-known sayings stating a general truth or a piece of advice. Every language or culture will have a collection of wise sayings that offer advice about how to live your life. A good conscience is a soft pillow. It means when you're always doing the right thing and have nothing to feel guilty about, you sleep well. Little strokes fell great oaks. You can complete a huge and scary task by steadily doing it in small portions. Easy come, easy go. Anything that is attained easily without much effort is easily lost or spent. The proof of pudding is in the eating. A person's character is judged by his or her actions. And what is this last one? What is the good of a sundial in a shade? It means one should not hide one's talents. Right? So now let's see how they are organized in your book. This is how you will have proverbs in match the proverb with its meaning format. In the exam again, you will match the proverbs with their meanings. All idioms, phrases, and proverbs, all these three will come as a part of round number 14 for 10 marks in your level 4 exam. All right? So organized based on themes with clear meanings and proper usage, our idioms, phrases, and proverbs will help you in expressing ideas in a few words and express something very vividly. And we are sure when you use idioms, phrases, and proverbs in your communication, it will surely awaken the listener's or reader's senses. So know them and use them. It will greatly improve the way you speak and write. Now, let's see our round number 15. This is your last round in your spelling. Before we learn to present an argument, let us first understand what is an argument. You say you know what it is? You have witnessed and have engaged in a few yourself? Well. This is the most commonly and popularly used meaning of the word argument. To fight, the first meaning here. To fight or to quarrel with someone who has an opinion different from yours. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the second meaning of the word, the one that I have circled here. I'm talking about the set of reasons given in support of an idea or theory, a line of reasoning, verbal reasoning. So what is this round 15 all about? About argument, about organizing your thought process. To put it simply, I could actually say, like you had jumbled words in Jumble Tumble, jumbled sentences and form the correct sentence. This is just jumbled sentences of a paragraph you will put in order and get it done with. But to put it in the way we have planned it for you, do you really want to know? I think you should know. We have taken you on a journey that ends here in round 15. I'll explain. In any spell bee, they give you just a set of words to memorize spellings, but some competitions will also add meanings or phonetics, synonyms, etc. Dear darling students, as you are in level 4, You have to understand and you have to got to listen to what you just finished, what you're about to finish. You're going to complete a wonderful roller coaster journey that started with learning morphemes, the smallest meaningful units of the language. Sounds of words, words, word forms, inflections and derivations, remember? And word combinations, collocations. You remember all this? So how a word is formed, what different forms it can take, with what other words do they combine, and how they become a phrase, clause, sentence. And of course, you learned synonyms, antonyms, idioms, phrases, literary devices too. You are now fully equipped with the building blocks to construct towering works of literary genius. And it is in this round, you're being trained to become a master communicator. So you need to understand, every communication has a goal. It might be to inform, to entertain, to persuade, to express feelings, or a number of other purposes. And in this round, we'll show you the different types of presenting information that serve whatever is your goal. Let's look at several options you have for structuring an argument. So I was telling you, this is how we have taken you. We've started from words and we're ending with profound literary expressions. So these are the different types. Story sequencing order. For a younger grade, it would be a very simple story about a monkey and two cats who quarrel with a piece of bread. And for an older grade student, it would be about organizing the story structure. For example, we have here the story of How to Train Your Dragon. This is one type, story sequencing. And there is logical order, a rhyme for a younger kid called Monday's Child, which proceeds in the days of the week. After Monday comes Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, in that order. And for group two, that's grade two student, you have setting up a fishbowl. What are the steps that you logically progress? And then we have chronological order. Chronology, nothing means, it just means time order. So it can be from the present to the past or from the past to the present. All right. So we have here some interesting biographies about Walt Disney, Joan of Arc, and Continental Drift. Continental Drift, how continents used to be one single landmass and how they, through the course of time, drifted apart, and the war of currents between Edison and Tesla, what really happened and who was a better scientist and who invented what and what transpired during the war of currents, and biography of Jackie Chan, plastic through the ages. We have the history of Olympic Games for group three. This is the order, chronological order. And what is analogical order? Analogy is nothing but comparison. So here we have Life is Like a Box of Chocolates. An expert from the movie script of a movie. And this is, all these are comparing one thing to another. The finally, we have here the closing argument of a lawyer where he compares the condition of the person who was about to be convicted to this little bird that is in the hands of a little boy who's hid that bird in his hand. This is for group number, I think, 8. It's a very interesting one. I think group 8 students will enjoy. So we have different types of ordering, as you can see here. And what is emphatic? Emphatic is the adjective form of the word emphasis. So the ordering can be either from small to big, from easy to difficult, from simple to most complex, or from least important to most important. Here we have many interesting ones. This is from group 5, so grade 5 students' book, Making Sense of Senses. So many people think people only have 5 basic senses. And our mom, she always says, with the gaining of the 6th sense, we have even lost all our 5 senses. This is our DK ma'am's quote. And this here in this exercise, we actually delve deeply into understanding what all the senses that we possess. And you can see actually here in point number 5 that we have more than 5 senses. Many neuroscientists identify 9 or 21, and some even list as many as 33 senses. So what are these different senses that we possess? This is emphatic order from simple to most complex. And we have deductive and inductive reasoning. We have climactic and anticlimactic order. Climactic is slowly progressing, reaching a crescendo and finishing with a very interesting, a very engrossing climax. Anticlimactic order is when the reverse of what you think happens, or it is also the order in which the newspapers print their articles. The most important one comes at the beginning. The headline gives the crux of the most important. Everything that's most important comes in the headline itself. That is the anticlimactic order. And when you read through the article, you will actually find that events are described in the decreasing order of importance. That is the anticlimactic order. And then we have compare and contrast order. We are comparing and contrasting dolphins and sharks, fruits and vegetables. That's very interesting. And Arctic and Antarctic. And here we have for a higher grade, that's grade 7. We have compare and contrast poem by Maya Angelou. I know why the caged bird sings. It's actually an allegory. She compares people who are free and people who are not to that of a caged bird and a free bird. And then we have cause and effect order. A very interesting one here we have here is what made the Nobel Prizes possible? A bad piece of journalism actually contributed to instituting the Nobel Prizes. This is for grade 5. And what causes extinction? A very thought-provoking read. So all of our articles, we penned ourselves. That will be very interesting for you to read. And problem and solution order. And then we have narrative paragraph or narrative poem. Here we are describing, this is in group 9, how a 12-year-old girl gave Pluto its name. So it's being narrated to you. A narrative paragraph will definitely have a different organization compared to other types of paragraphs, right? It's more like you're listening to a story. A persuasive paragraph will make you want to act based on what you're listening. So here we have a poem on democracy. And then we have the final speech from the movie The Great Dictator. And then we have a process paragraph or how-to paragraph. How to read poetry by Billy Collins is a good read here. This is in grade 8. And how to survive a quicksand, that is in group 7. If you really want to know, take the group 7 book and see how to survive a quicksand. And analytical writing. Here we analyze why something is done. So the tone in which it's written, the choice of words, the way it is written will be very different, right? So here we are analyzing why the Russians used to put a frog in the milk. There's a frog in milk. Yeah, for good reason. Actually, they used to put this brown frog to preserve the milk from getting spoiled. So every night Russians put, yes, this really happened. It's not an old wives' tale. And now they're actually researching on what enzymes these frogs are secreting that keeps the milk from getting spoiled. And then we have experimental report writing. This is an experiment of 5 monkeys. And argument and counter-argument. We have a real case scenario between 2 lawyers, and then we have arguments and counter-arguments about animal testing. That's a very good one. So you understand the purpose of this round is make you understand the purpose of this round primarily is for you to construct your own literary expressions, because words and all these inflections, collocations, and synonyms, antonyms, like I just told you, are just building blocks. And you are to build your own towering works of literary genius. And here I have a video that we have prepared actually for a conference, but this would be driving the point straight to you. This would make you think and understand the importance of words and on how they can and have shaped the world as we know it today.
Fight on the seas and oceans. We shall fight with growing confidence and growing strength in the air, whatever the cost may be. We shall fight on the beaches, we shall fight on the landing grounds, we shall fight in the fields and in the streets, we shall fight in the hills. We shall never surrender.
Do we not owe it to ourselves, to our children, to tormented mankind, to make sure that these catastrophes do not engulf us?
Never give in. Never, never, never. In nothing, great or small, large or petty, never give in except to convictions of honor and good sense. Never yield to force. Never yield to the apparently overwhelming might of the enemy. I have nothing to offer but blood, toil, tears, and sweat.
It is for us, the living, rather, to be dedicated here to the unfinished work which they who fought here have thus far so nobly advanced. It is rather for us to be here, dedicated to the great task remaining before us, that from these honored dead, we take increased devotion to that cause for which they gave the last full measure of devotion. That we here highly resolve that these dead shall not have died in vain. That this nation, under God, shall have a new birth of freedom. And that government of the people, by the people, for the people, shall not perish from the earth.
The government has now decided that a large task force will sail as soon as all preparations are complete.
Prime Minister, we do still have 3 weeks before our ships reach the islands. All we're saying is that we shouldn't give up on trying to find a diplomatic solution.
The U.S. Secretary of State has arrived, Prime Minister.
So you are proposing to go to war over these islands. They're thousands of miles away, a handful of citizens, politically and economically insignificant, if you'll excuse me.
Just the coin, I imagine.
I'm sorry.
1941, when Japan attacked Pearl Harbor, did America go cap in hand and ask Tojo for a peaceful negotiation of terms? Did she turn her back on her own citizens there because the islands were thousands of miles away from the mainland United States? No, no, no. We will stand on principle, or we will not stand at all.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm indeed delighted to be with the honorable members of the European Parliament on the occasion of the Golden Jubilee Year of the European Union. I am reminded of the dream of an Indian poet, Kanyan Pungundradar, who articulated in 3,000 years back in Tamil classic Puranam. He says, Yadu Mure, Yavarin Keli, which means, I am a world citizen. Every citizen is my own kith and kin, he said 3,000 years back. As he said in India, where there is righteousness in the heart, where there is righteousness in the heart, there is beauty in the character. When there is beauty in the character, there is harmony in the home. When there is harmony in the home, there is harmony, but there is an order in the nation. When there is order in the nation, there is peace in the world.
President Abdul Kalam, in the name of the European Parliament, I want to thank you for this important and inspiring speech. This was one of the most extraordinary speeches we have ever heard. From a statesman scientist and poet. This is unique. All the best to this great nation. All the best to all cooperation between the great nation India and the European Union. All the best, Mr. President.
Hello, I'm Severin Suzuki speaking for ECHO, the Environmental Children's Organization. We're a group of 12 and 13-year-olds trying to make a difference. We've raised all the money to come here ourselves, to come 5,000 miles to tell you adults you must change your ways. Coming up here today, I have no hidden agenda. I am fighting for my future. Losing my future is not like losing an election or a few points on the stock market. I am here to speak for all generations to come. I am here to speak on behalf of the starving children around the world whose cries go unheard, for the countless animals dying across this planet because they have nowhere left to go. I am afraid to breathe the air because I don't know what chemicals are in it. I used to go fishing with my dad until just a few years ago we found the fish full of cancers. And now we hear of animals and plants going extinct, every day vanishing forever. I have dreamt of seeing the great herds of wild animals, jungles and rainforests full of birds and butterflies. But now I wonder if they will even exist for my children to see. All this is happening before our eyes, and yet we act as if we have all the time we want and all the solution. You don't know how to bring back an animal now extinct, and you can't bring back the forest that once grew where there is now a desert. If you don't know how to fix it, please stop breaking it. Here, you may be delegates of your government, business people, or politicians, but really, your mothers and fathers, sisters and brothers, aunts and uncles, and all of you are someone's child. I'm only a child, yet I know we are all part of a family, billions strong. In fact, 30 million species strong. I'm only a child, yet I know we are all in this together, spent on war, spent on finding environmental answers, ending poverty, and finding treaties. What a wonderful place this earth would be. And now 20 years have gone by. We have not even come close to achieving the sustainable transition that we knew we needed back then.
You can find that many of the excerpts here are in your presenting and argument. So with this, I want to wish you all the very best for your L4 competition and to all of your own future profound literary expressions, because I'm very aware that I'm speaking with the torchbearers of the next generation. You are the original thinkers, the powerful communicators, the thought leaders, transformational entrepreneurs, visionaries, and leaders. And it is on your shoulders to usher in a new kind of planetary citizenship. To quote Walt Whitman's, leaves of grass, go sound your barbaric yop over the roofs of the world. Go forth, children, conquer the world.